Good evening. Welcome to the last design forum of this very rich design forum semester. And it's a very special evening, and I welcome you here tonight. Those of you who have been at SciArc for some, let's see, 4 or 5 years, remember previous visits of Hermann Hertzberger. This is his third visit to SciArc. And I picked up his CV, which is by this time over a quarter of an inch thick in terms of work, honors, publication, and background information. But I think most of you know of the man, one of the greatest of the Dutch architects, I think, with a beautiful body of work, which I'm delighted to say has been very well documented in a new book just off the press, published, I believe, in Switzerland. And we're going to be getting it for the library, but if any of you want to order the book, there's a special student application book order that I'll leave here on the podium for later. It's really special. I'll leave it here, actually. See it. So we have this ongoing relationship with Hermann Hertzberger where he's come here and then we've gone to Europe, to Holland, to see his work. We've traveled with students in 79 when Ray and I took the second Europe semester class, and we looked at his work then, and every year since then when students have gone, they've looked at his work. Sometimes they visited his office, and when Rick Rietveld was here teaching and lecturing, he also showed some of the work that he had worked on with Hermann. And so tonight it gives me a great deal of pleasure to introduce Hermann Hertzberger, who will be talking maybe retrospectively and also especially on some of his new exciting work in Europe. Hermann Hertzberger. You don't need a lavalier mic, right?
Are you going to do the slides?
Yes, up there.
Yes.
And look, you have.
Where's the pointer?
And here's the pointer. Okay.
Thank you.
All right.
Yeah. In fact, I've no introduction. I just wanted to show you some work of which, well, you might have seen some of the things I'm showing. There's some very dangerous thing here, that is the video, and they record everything you have said a couple of years ago. So this is the only place you in fact are supposed to come with a brand new story every time again. And that's really is difficult because the work is not going so fast. It's really going step by step, and so you might see something you have been seeing before. Can I have some slides? And hello. He's and yeah. this is the office building, which takes most of my time and on which I'm working since 79. That may be very slow for American standards, but such a building for more than 2,000 people and Dutch bureaucracy, I can tell you, takes takes all of your energy. Although it's quite an easy building, you know, it is just made from these islands, and in fact these islands are repeated over and over again. So it's quite simple, you have to design one of these islands, and you put more of them together, and you have the building. However, yeah, that saves time, you would say. But the point is that in order to be able to make an element, a unit, which works so well that you can repeat it in this way, you have to do a lot of research. What it is, in fact, is a building which tries not to be just one box. And most of the office buildings that are made in the world, in fact, are sort of boxes. And what I try to do is make a sort of settlement of smaller office buildings that together form a sort of unity. And if you look at the skeleton, in fact, it's based on the most boring column scheme you can imagine. It is just simply columns put in line like soldiers, and just this lining up, it's just going on and on. And it's very cheap, and there are no complications. However, the idea is to make a periphery that is so long that all the offices can have daylight from outside. And in the middle, there is this sort of atrium-like communal spaces which are connected in this way and form a sort of, one could say, public related to the office spaces which are all rooms, a sort of public space that is tying the whole system together. So instead of the Centrale de Heer building, next slide, this is could I have the next slide? No, could you do it? I love to have it done, you know? Yeah. So this is just rooms, and in fact the, yeah, if you don't mind, I like to say that. This is the old office building, which was also based on the idea of elements that are put together. And in the new office building, which is a totally different organization, they asked for rooms, and lots of rooms. And I hope the next time that I come here, if I'll ever be invited again, I'm going to really show you what it is, because the construction starts now. And in 3 years' time, it'll be finished, and there are some features in it which I'm not going to talk about, because I think it's quite you should not talk about plans too much, about all the nice things you have in your head before they are really turned out to work. And I'm not sure yet. This old building also made units, and units of sort of islands on which 12 to 16 people work. They are open islands, and they were connected with bridges. You can maybe see this bridge. No, you don't see them in the photograph, because they're too many. number articulated in groups. This groups is in fact the way, based on the way, on the organization of the work, and they in fact split up the building in smaller buildings that give the feeling to the people who are working there that they are not just working in this big massive thing, but so to say in their own smaller building. Next, you see the interior of the working spaces. Here you see the islands, and the islands are tied together with the bridges, and everybody's free to decorate and arrange his office. And you have always this point where you look down in between the islands to the next working space, which still works quite well. And what you see in this picture is the central space in between the working spaces, where the people go out to drink coffee and to discuss and to have their visitors received. And the idea was to make it in such materials and in such proportions that you may think of a Mediterranean town, a little bit, or small village, and it's supposed to give the impression of being outside. So you are not always the whole day long in that building, but you get the atmosphere of the outside. And this is due to the materials, the pavement we usually have in the street, the masonry you usually have outside, and the light coming from above and having this verticality, which together strengthen the feeling of being outside. So it is trying to play with the idea that you can make the inside more outside, as well as what you could do, the reverse of the thing, making an outside more inside. Thus, relativate, is that an English expression to say relativate? I don't want to say relate. I want to say that the inside becomes the outside and the outside becomes the inside, so you don't know anymore about inside and outside. The whole idea of inside and outside collapses, you know. Hmm? Next, the same thing happens in the music center in Utrecht, where this was a sort of leftover space in connection with a big American style shopping center with interior streets, and they left over this small point for cultural things, you know, and there were very strict building lines I could not pass, and the idea was to just continue the internal streets, and therefore it did not become one block, which you might expect from the music center, but seeing from this side, you see that there's different blocks. The idea was in the old town, where there are smaller fragments and not these big blocks, to so to say cut the building into this piece. Next, when you go in this entrance here, and you come into this shopping arcade, which is also an outside street and an inside street. So it's again hesitating between inside and outside. And the idea has been not to make a music temple, a temple sort of thing, where you, which is just for the in crowd, for the people who love Beethoven and Mozart, and they were educated in that, and they know where the entrance is, and the other people think, well, this is not for us. And the idea is that you have all sort of shops, like shops where you can get well, whatever you want, you know, shoes and clothes, and then at that side there's a very big shop where you can get music. And the idea is that sometimes this doors are open, and then the people are just walking in, and they hear music, and they are listening to the music. Or some people want to just make this shortcut here, and then they come in, and they hear music, and they come in the actual hall, and they forget what they were doing. This is not my story, but that is real. There were lots of people that tried to buy something and ended up in the concert hall. This is, of course, an ideal thing to have that always, to have it permanently, and this does not work permanently. It is just once a week, but even that once a week is, I think, important enough, and that it works in that way. So in fact, it is layers. It is layered in the sense of that you have first this shopping arcade around, and then when you are entering the building, you have the layer of foyer space that is around, and then the nucleus of the whole thing is the actual symphony hall. Next. Here you are in the same hall. Could you separate them a little bit? Maybe? Yeah, well, a little bit. Yeah, okay. At night time or in the evening, and at daytime. And you see in the corners there are larger places, place-like pieces where you have a good connection with the second floor, which is also shopping arcade part. All the lighting was made by us everywhere, and I think it's quite important to not leave to the technicians, because it's affecting and, so to say, establishing the atmosphere a great deal. Next. This is the hall itself. Now you may put them a little bit together. Could you? Am I difficult? A little bit more. Lovely to have the hall. But still more. If they touch, you can see how the hall is. And you see that it, in fact, well, it's not quite working, but you get an understanding. This hall is in fact a symphony hall, but it can also be used for rock and pop concerts, which you see here. And then they take out all the seats, and it's just full of people. So instead of 1,700, I don't know, the numbers of people are secret for the fire. And also, all the steps are full of people, and officially it's still 1,700 people. What you see here is a theater-like setup, and the idea is that should be thus that you can see as much as here, which is different from the classical one, you know, the classical music symphony hall. People are supposed to sit and hear with their eyes closed and thinking, knowing the beautiful music that comes in their head, etc. But I think this may be good for people who know the music, but not for those who are not educated with it. And I think it's quite important when you are not educated in Beethoven to have the help of the seeing of the different instruments, and you can relate this to the color of the sound you hear, and that gives you a better understanding. It also is quite nice to see at the other side of the hall that your friend has a new girl, Frank, and that he is still there, and she is also there, and you have this sort of big family feeling when you are not sitting in rows but sitting in the round. And also the idea of making this quiet in the round is that the players are just in the middle, and the public is around. Very important is these places here that are sort of open spaces in front of the entrance. Next, please. Now you may separate them again. It's very important to not fill up your whole hall with seats, but have some spare room which is used for dancing during rock concerts, and which is also for the people who were supposed to buy shoes and clothes and came in, and this man, you see, he was just having shoes, and they're a little bit stupidly standing there, not believing their ears and eyes, and so to say, on the street. These benches in the wrong direction are very popular because they are made, in fact, for not during the concert but during the intermission, that you're looking in the other direction to the foyer side where the doors are open and you see people in the foyer passing, and thus having the actual hall part of the foyer thing, and not just a closed off space. But in fact they are very popular because people love to sit in a not quite comfortable way on them. And I did not know that. I found that out. As an architect you are inclined to say we must make benches and things as comfortable as possible. But it seems not to be true, because there are lots of people who love this sort of difficult sitting position, and psychologically it means that they are not yet sure they'll stay. And this psychology of not being sure that you want to stay gives you the liberty. When you are seated and you are there, you cannot go away. But this feeling of, well, maybe I listen, I give it another 3 minute chance, and then I go, is the sort of thing which is quite important. You see, always in this hall, people standing, people hanging, and I think this is very nice. Very nice idea, which is not quite designed by myself, but by making different a variety of possibilities, different things, you let all this sort of spontaneous thing in and let them happen. Next, please. Here you see the same story. This big pivoting doors, they they are opened, and then the people, and then there's a complete connection with the foyer space around, and it's not just this closed off hall, but you have the spaces around are part of the thing. Next. This is the foyer space, and here you see the opening you can have with the foyer. And in this foyer space, there is, you see in this thing, one of the principles I try to have in all the things I'm making, which is providing an extra accommodation to put things, especially in a foyer of a music center. You always, every time, you need to place your bottles and your things, and it is not necessary to make special things for that, because a balustrade, what you need, because otherwise you might fall down, will help you if you just make put a sill to it to accommodate this extra thing. Also, here are made niches, and niches are effective just to hang things to the wall, small exhibitions and things, but I did not open it up until the floor, but left this sort of base. And this base was not made for sitting, and these people there are not quite sitting, but they found a place where they could, I don't know what word you would use for that, but it may be sitting. But in fact, all this sort of sidewalk, thing, where people can find a place, an official place. And of course, next to this unofficial place, there are also the official seats and benches. But so many occasions, you're not saying, let's sit on a, let's try to find a seat. You're just meeting somebody and, so to say, find the minimal condition to stay and to hang. Next. This is to show you that there is also this big skylight, which is quite unusual. I don't know about this idea to have daylight in a symphony hall, but I think it's quite important to have it, because on Sunday morning there are many concerts, and when it's nice weather, it's terrible to go into a black box and have a concert and then come out, and then you all of a sudden you realize that you missed such a beautiful weather. And also, I found out, lots of the things I'm saying were not consciously designed, but I found them out afterwards and used them, so to say, as experience for the next building. I mean, I'm not so terribly good that I realized that all the rehearsals of the orchestra, being done in the morning, taking place in the big hall, always and everywhere in the world, are done in the dark. And it's not so funny to have daily rehearsals in this artificial light, if there is a possibility to have the skylight open and rehearse in the daylight. And I found out that the people really love to just rehearse in the daylight. And the other thing is that when there's a concert and they leave the shields, what is it? They have something to blend it, huh? When they leave that open, this is going to be a big lamp that tells the town that something in the music center is going on, which I think is a quite good quality, which is the reverse of the quality of letting the light in. It's a considerable adventure to make such a skylight. Everybody who has the experience of building with all the acoustical and all the physics problems that are raised can imagine that it's not so simple. And you really must be convinced to do such a thing. And you know, it was the most difficult thing of the whole hall to make such a thing. But I think it is really worth to have it. It can transform the hall into, say, a church-like space. Next, this was some old stuff. Now I'm going to show you something you might not have seen, which is in Berlin, the housing project for the IBA I did in Berlin. And this was the lot that was given to me. And when I saw that on first glance, I said, how beautiful to have such a cake point. Piece of pastry, which is so fashionable. You know, flat iron. I can make a flat iron building. Everybody does that, and you know, this is the thing to do, flat iron building. But a couple of minutes later, I found out that there was a church already sitting on the point, and you know, it's always the church. The last years, it's always the churches that make problems to my work. So this church was already sitting here, so there was nothing left but making, curving this back and give priority to the church. And this is this block we made, and the idea was to make not an inner court, where always the poor houses in Berlin, if you know about Berlin, this is tradition, that the poor houses are on the inner courts, and the still poorer houses are on the second and even on the third inner court. But that was a risky thing to do. However, with this big gateways, all these gates here, I thought that it would work as a quite public place, say, part of the street. And it is true that people who are coming from this street and want to go there, make the shortcut just walking through that inner court. Next, please. What you see here is the edge of the thing, and you see here the beautiful neighborhood building with lots of windows, and here also. What you see, in fact, is that although this house is made is plastered, which was the cheapest and most regular thing to do in the Berlin context, I cannot stand the abstraction of this plastered building. I love the architecture from the 20th and from the 30th and this abstraction, but I found out that I'm such a Dutchman in the sense of have my roots in Berlage and this people, that I cannot stand to make a window without making a lintel over it. When I make a window, small or big, I always want to show with an element the way it is not falling down, you know, the way it is keeping itself. And in this beautiful modern architecture of the 20s and 30s, it is all based on hope and trust that it does not fall down. You know, it is the sort of not explaining how it is made. And I'm terrible at this thing. So gradually more concrete columns, everywhere, columns and lintels, beams and everything were exposed at the outside, and finally made just a whole pattern. I'm explaining this because you might think that this was just made as a graphical thing. That is not true. It just came, so to say, to the outside because I could not stand the idea of having this all abstract. Next, please. The main thing of this project is the balconies. And the balconies in Berlin are quite important. Berlin people love balconies more than anywhere else, and they love them big, and from the first day they got them, they were full of flowers, and they're really used. And the idea I had is making balconies with an intimate space, an intimate zone, and a more extrovert zone, so that you can sit in a protected place, protected by this glass brick, translucent glass brick wall, that you can sit on your own without seeing your neighbor, and that there's also a zone where you are in the view of your neighbor, an introvert zone, and two steps ahead you have the sky over you. You have a larger dimension, you know, you are, so you see it here. Every balcony has one piece, which is quite free and higher, and the other balcony is here. It also has this dimension, and also an intimate spot here. So I try to organize these balconies in such a way that you have this two zones, and I think that is quite important. And this plastic solution you get out of is not made from the idea. That's what I'm trying to say. Let's make something plastic. You know, you see so many students' projects, and consequently also projects for people who were students and now became architects, who try to do all sorts of things, you know, because you, I don't know, all, you know, to make it interesting. And that's that is, I think, a misunderstanding. It's not necessary to use elements to make the architecture interesting. It is just having the program. When you have a program of what you want to establish, the elements are there, and it will be interesting without doing that on purpose or not. And if not, well, it will be a flat building. Next. You see, I did this already in Kassel, another scheme in Germany. You see the difference. In fact, there's not so much difference. It's the same idea of this secluded corner, and here this open this openness to the neighbor. So when you don't want to be disturbed, you are behind this thing in this zone here. And when you want to be disturbed, or you want to disturb somebody else, you are in this zone. So when you are in need for some coffee, you stand here, you ask your neighbor to throw some coffee to you. And if you want to read and not being disturbed, you are behind that thing. You see the difference with the Berlin scheme that I work with is with this balustrade with holes. And in fact, I think a balustrade, well, you know, in Berlin it is all in steel, it's lighter, and it's because I wanted to change. In fact, this stone and wall thing works so perfectly that I could go on with it for the rest of my life. I know everything about the thing. They are quite inexpensive. I know what's going to happen with them. They're a big success. Small children can look through it, which is quite nice. And you can put plants in it the way you see it here. And so it's just something that works. Still, I stop with it because I it's like a book I've read so many times that I think, well, now I know it by heart. And I think it's one of the safety things. What is it? Safety character pieces of your character. When you are at a certain moment, you think, well, I can't stand it anymore, because otherwise you go on and you are not renewing yourself. So there's in fact this drive to renew yourself by just the fact that you cannot stand it anymore, although it being quite successful. So those people who love the success and think, I'm going on with it because it was so successful, they are in constant danger and they are degrade after certain. So I think I have this feeling that independent of whether it's a success or not, at a certain moment you can't stand it anymore. So, however, next, I was not the first one to invent this big balconies, and I've explained this before, but it is the year of Le Corbusier now, so it's fair to show some Le Corbusier. I hope you can still stand Le Corbusier. Most of the schools, they had such large series of Le Corbusier that after not having heard of him several years, they're now suffocated with Le Corbusier, which is also dangerous. Because he was a really good man, and he was not the man who invented, as is often said, this big terrible apartment house. In fact, he invented this apartment house, you know. They invented all this. He invented these big things, you know. But you must realize that he always proposed to do it with this big loggias. And with such a loggia, can you imagine to have just a house as big as a house in two floors, you know, something with your house? That it would be very fun to be in a big apartment house, I think. And this is the pavilion. So he did it already in 1922, and this is the pavilion, the Lesnil Hall, he made in Paris in 1925, a full scale of a model of the thing he was proposing all the time. But and I think it's terrific to make full scale details and to see what this should look like. And we were not born at that time, but happy enough. Next slides. They remade the thing completely in Bologna in Italy. And you must go there. Have you been there?
Yes.
It's incredible. It was such a shock, such an eye opener that I realized that so many years after he invented it, we are still insisting of not making reasonable balconies, and the qualities of this are just smashing, you know. The fact that he makes this not just as an outlook, but this big outlook, he puts in the possibility to at certain moments not look out. When you have your party, when you have something more intimate, you can close, so to say, the windows, which shows, you know, that that he is really thinking of the all the situations in daily life of people. And of course, he makes this small sill, you know, to put plants up at a table. If you don't like plants, there's also a place where you have no sill, and when you have a nice table, you can put it here. And it's just very rich with possibilities. Next. Going back to Berlin, you see here the axonometric scheme where you see how the street is going on in the interior. And here you see one of these gates that you can pass publicly, freely. And the idea of the staircases that are sort of vertical, glazed streets. Next, and in the inner court, you see a large sand pit, and this site is not made by Gaudi, but my daughter, who is also an architect, and she loves to do things with many people together. She hates the idea of working on herself, but she wants always to work with others together. And she proposed to go to Berlin and make nice decorations on the sand pit together with the people. So she went there with a couple of Gaudi books and said, "Here, this is what Gaudi made. What about us making the same sort of thing?" And she had organized large tables here and mosaic pieces from building material manufacturers and cemento and everything. And the small children started, the children from 3 or 4 years started to make mosaics, pieces, and then the older children followed, and then after some time also the grown-ups started to work on it. And they all made pieces, just the tablets of the thing, and they were all assembled. And when she went back to Holland, they went on, and the whole process was going. And it's just fantastic, because it's not only nicely decorated, but it's also since they were working on it themselves, and not just the architect, and not just the builders, they appropriated the thing completely. It became their sandpit. They forgot, so to say, that there were ever builders and architects to start the engine, and they did it, and they put now much more care in it than they ever would have done without this collaboration. And of course, this is the idea of the pergolas, and of course, this sewage pieces of concrete. What is it? Sewage pipes, elements. They are just quite cheap, and you put earth in it, and you put plants in it, and after some time, you'll have a roof. But this also can be left to the inhabitants, because it's their thing now. So you can stop as an architect at a certain moment and leave quite a lot to the inhabitants. Yes? Next. So here you see what it looks and I you know no, this is not yet coming. There was a black one here. That's okay. You know all these columns that came from supporting this overhanging balconies. In fact, show a large dimension in this housing project. I found out that is very, very important. And all of a sudden, I realized that most of the housing projects they have always this 70, which is always this 2.70 everywhere, which is going to be quite boring, you know. And it's I think very good to have this larger measure, this larger dimension in it, which you also see in the old quite monumental house at the other side. Next, I'm showing you now the film center, which we are supposed to build, and it was I was not going to show it, but since I saw on the paper that was on the wall that it was there, that I had to put it in. The idea is that there is in Berlin an old leftover stuff of a hotel. The hotel has been quite big and quite symmetrical and quite aristocratic, and that in that place there are lots of films started, made, and lots of situations in big hotel. You can understand all the things they loved in the time when the German film industry was quite popular. Were playing, were being made in that hotel, and they wanted to keep that as the center of the film, of this whole film house. And this was a competition I won. The idea is that there is a museum, a library, all for film, and a school, an academy, and a big studio. And instead of putting this in one big box, I left the elements quite autonomous and tried to make good relationships between the parts. And oh yes, there's also a big cinema in here. So cinema, studio, the center is for a restaurant and administration and representative spaces. And the museum and the library. And underneath is a connection with all the archives and everything. And I tried to work on the idea of making a settlement of this quite autonomous buildings with good relationships. And there's a sort of, well, it's not quite well in this model, a quite prominent, a sort of arcade thing with ramps that pierce the building and that tie all the different parts of the building. So you can make a walk all through this whole little town. And I gradually more try to work with this round, almost self-contained forms. But this is quite dangerous, because when you work with these cylinders, they tend to become sort of castles. And so you must be very aware of the fact that a cylinder becomes a cylinder becomes a sort of castle thing. But could you give me the previous one? What I did was not making cylinders, but I have cut off pieces of it, you know. And also underneath here, this one seems to be a cylinder, but it is not. There's a piece underneath is eaten from it. And that's quite essential, because you see it here, that in fact, this the cylinders are not really cylinders, and the space in between is a sort of neat, quite regular, rectangular I use this cut-off, half-consumed cylinder leftovers to make quite nice spaces in between. Now you may give me next, because this is a principle. Which you can also find in 20th century painting, you know, like this Cézanne painting. It is not so much the fruit, the apples and the pears he wanted to paint, but it is the space in between he tried to get, you know. So the relationship between the objects. So it was not so much the objects he painted, but their relationship. The same thing is true with the Morandi painting, where it's not so much the pots as well as the space or the relationship of the pots, you know. As such, these pots are quite uninteresting and even quite boring. And some of them you don't want to have in your house. But he was working very long, longer than the actual painting, on putting these pots together in such a way that they together form a sort of settlement. And in fact, it is the relationship of these pots which was his theme throughout his life. And this is the sort of things that I learned from in my work. Next, please. So the same thing is going to happen as what you see in this Gaudi plate here. You see that this plate is although it is smashed in pieces, it is still a unity, but it is less unity than it has been before it was smashed. This is quite obvious, but also because in the environment of other pieces, there's not this one relationship of the place and its environment, but there's also a relationship of the pieces with the pieces around. So, you know, they are a little bit more like their surroundings, you know. So see, this piece is as much part of this entity or of this entity, you know, as it is of this whole entity. So to say it in other words, you could say the plate is a family. And then when it was not yet smashed, it was a family of brave small children who did everything their parents wanted them to do. And at a certain moment, these members of the family became, so to say, self, got an identity of their own. They're still forming a family. Sometimes they come and sit together. But in many cases they are part of a new entity, of different entities. They have the freedom to be part of more entities than just this thing. So it takes the object quality out of the plate, and it, so to say, can be different things, you know. I'm always with that word to relative. I don't know what it is in English. I mean, I'm missing some point, you know. There is a sort of relativity going on, that the pieces can be considered as part of different entities and not just the entity of the plate. I hope this is clear, you know. And it's very important, very much 20th century. In this sense, Gaudi was the first, um, uh, the first to make what we afterwards would call a collage. So this whole plate with different foods is now, you know, you understand what I try to do, and we are just, you know, trying to not to stress, so to say, the idea of the different pieces of fruit, the banana and the apple and so on, but try to make it into one building with one building order, the same materials, the same grammar, and this is what we are working on today. Next, please. This is the last project I did. It is a competition. Again, one I did not win. More you do, you know, the most of the competitions you are not winning, but sometimes there are nice themes coming out of it, which you can use another time. This is the existing museum complex in Berlin. So here's the Philharmonie, and here's the Film House, and here's the Sharon Library. So it's a quite famous place here around the Forum of Hollein. And there was an architect who was making this museum complex, and you know, this is applied arts, this etching, this is a big entrance hall, and here was supposed to come the picture gallery, and here the sculpture gallery. But at a certain moment, when they saw what he made, what he built, they became afraid, because it was such a network of shifted and not in you know, displaced spaces, that they stopped him and made a competition for the picture gallery. And this is my proposal in between these two existing quite beautiful houses, and with respecting the museum as it was planned, I propose to make a large inner court, and having alleys, museum alleys, a whole landscape of museum alleys. And if you want to go through the collection, the art collection, you just chronologically, you start here, you go through that alley, you go back, and you forth, and back and forth, and you find a hole from the Middle Ages until the 20th century, you go that whole way. And the idea is that you are not obliged to do it chronologically, because there are always these openings in this wall, and then you can make shortcuts. And every square you see here is 50 centimeters higher than the previous one. So in fact, if you're walking up in pieces, just going up and up and up and down and down and down. So it's really a landscape with this 4 feet wide, thick walls and opening slits in between. And when you're walking here, you know, you can look through in this direction, and you see all the small ramps, and you're looking in this direction, just in another period of time. Right? You're walking in the Middle Ages, and you're just seeing that somewhere Rococo. And you can also look in the other, in the diagonal sense. And the fantastic thing is that when you're looking when you're looking in the perpendicular direction, you see it going up. And when you're looking in the diagonal sense, the floor remains at the same height. Cool. And when you are And at the end, you are looking out in the inner court, where there are supposed to be beautiful trees and a pond with fishes and a terrace without wind, coffee and everything. And here at this side, you are looking out in the town through this undulated is in the, here you see in the section, just very large alleys where you can put little houses in for special painting. If you like one big painting, you could put it in here. But we did not draw it because we wanted to show the space. You see here the surface alleys on top, and here all the lighting, natural light and filters and things and everything you need to have the good light quality. And there are niches in the thick walls for more intimate paintings. And here you see in what way you go through the wall and just make a shortcut going in this direction or here or wherever you want. And it's also possible, theoretically, to cut out a large piece of the wall and see in the next alley. This alley is about as wide as this room in the direction, so it's quite large super structure of walls with lots of possibilities of smaller things in between. Next, I think that it's just a system, an ID, so to say, for a museum which is not quite mature, but which I think might work. Here you see the scheme. This is the one color represents the same height, so you can see that when you look through in this direction, you remain on the same level, and here, and there, and there, and there, and there. And here you see the main direction of the alleys. Next, please. Graphically, you can see the different views, the different outlooks you have symbolically said in another period, but just physically that you are not just limited to these alleys. And in fact, you need to make walls to be able to make openings that seduce you to go in the next. By just making columns, you have one big hole, and I think instead of making columns, I try to make big columns that are so big that they are pieces of wall, and that the openings in between are so to say more underlined than they would have been with this column. Next, here you see all the schemes together. I just wanted to show this to you because it's the very last thing, and I'm just, you know, when you make a competition, you always hope you win it, and when it's done, when it's delivered, you forget it, and you think, well, you know, I'm not going to win it, and that's it. Huh? Next. Huh? And this next was not for the pictures now, yeah? But sometimes you think, it's really pity. But I found out that the 13 competitions I did, most of the work was not, was very helpful because they come themes and ideas that are in the drawers. And when you are in a situation, you have to do something. You have all this work, all the themes, so to say, at your disposal. Disposition or disposal. Next, please. Now, a little bit about the Corbusier. You all know this house in Poissy, so well known, that why do I show it? Well, in fact, I show it because of the picture next to it, which is not the interior of this house, it could have been, it's one of the great number of pictures of drawings in Corbusier made. And the very interesting thing of this drawing is that there's not much architecture in it. And you can see that he makes the windows not up to the top like here, you know, it could have been an interior of this room in fact. But for the rest, well,
time he has drawn on it was on funny things like teapots and teacups and a Bible or something laying here, and all sorts of plants and a funny radio and wood for the stove. Can you imagine all these nonsense? And all this this bottle with wine and red wine, white wine, and milk, and what else have you? And towels and linen and everything is in it, you know. And look at the beautiful curtains he did with all these dots on it. And you must realize that Le Corbusier was drawing this himself. And I don't know whether you ever have drawn something, but if so, then you know that when you are drawing a cup, you're thinking of a cup. It's impossible to draw a cup and think of a cat. And it is, and it's certainly impossible to draw a teapot and thinking of the golden section or something, or draw a curtains. And think of the Parthenon. No, when you are making, when you are drawing curtains, you have to think of curtains. And that means that you have to think of curtains. Curtains, of people that have curtains. Can you imagine? And all that sort of thing. So it proves that Le Corbusier was thinking of people. Can you imagine that? Le Corbusier was thinking of, well, this is not, I mean, I have been in your studio for half an hour this afternoon, but I listened quite thoroughly. I did not say a word because, you know, you cannot do that when you are just half an hour in, not even half an hour. But there was not one argument, not one remark that directly or even indirectly referred to or connoted to or alluded to anything that has to do with humans, you know. It was just about, I don't know what sort of jargon I heard about all sorts of things, not about any animal, not about any human being. Yet somebody like Le Corbusier was taking his time to think, to put himself in place of all the things that are going together with people. And you know, it is very popular to talk about the golden section and I don't know what of this formal order, which is really very strong in Le Corbusier. But what I'm saying is just one side of the medal, and the other side of the medal is of the Le Corbusier medal is this. So together with the formal order, you have the informal the daily life thing. And to understand about Le Corbusier, and maybe I could say to understand about architecture, you should not miss the other half of the medal. You know? Otherwise, you just see it from one side. You behind. Next. You know, going into the terrace of that same house in Poissy, you see that Le Corbusier, well, there he is again. The same teapot, the same cup, the same book. He's now reading in the book. Another cup. And everything, you know, all these things, architects are just not aware of. I mean, they think that is something for at home, not in the studio or something like that, you know. And then look at the plants. When you see architects drawing plants, they always have this sort stereotype greenery, you know. This is something, you know, you do this, and then
all your colleagues know that you mean green. Hmm? It's a sort of thing you have, you know, you put it in and that's green. And some people do it like this and other people do it like that. But that's standing for green. And only architects and architect students know what it means. Like, you know, some funny thing that means toilet. Some thing that means stairs. So they have something that means green. It's not really green, you know, but it's just something that stands for or connotes green. However, the Corbusier, he's not making green, but he's making plants. And it seems that he knows about his plants, and it seems that he somewhere likes them, because when you draw something, you must like it in some way or another. And or maybe he hates the plants. But then he hates them in such a way that I'm drawing them, you know, one after the other. Huh? So he has at least a sort of, I don't know what, relationship with the plants, but he's not just saying, and this is green. And that is very remarkable. And again, this is putting yourself in place of the things really being busy with concrete things instead of this terrible abstraction of the architect's job. I want to point out one of, especially what's going on here, to explain you something about the precision of this man. I mean, when you say architecture is art, then there must be poetics in it. And poetics means precision. Poetics is not what many of you might think. Poetics is something like sweet and you know, with feeling, something, you know, like this. No, poetics is precision. A poet is able to say things more precise than somebody else, you know, with less words, saying more, saying the thing. And it all comes down to the ultimate precision. I show you how precise Le Corbusier is and how poetic in the sense that he does two things at a time. Next, please. And this is this plant box and roof light at the same time. Because when you look at it from nearby, it is not only a plant box, but there's also a roof light in it, you know? And instead of making just a roof light and a plant box, he could make the thing together, which is quite nice, quite precise, in the sense that the thing is quite vulnerable, and with the plants around, it's more or less protected. And also, it's quite nice, because a roof light cuts a quite of very contrasted piece of white in the dark, and by having these plants, it is diaphragmated in a beautiful way. And the skylight in the garage, when you enter the garage with your car and you open the door and you look up, you see members of your family and you are really already at home. I think this is of a precision, of such a precision, in the sense of feeling and knowing what you are doing, that you can say, in this case, architecture starts to become art. I'm sorry for all those people who went to the School of Architecture with the feeling, with the idea to become an artist, but by making, you know, this sort of sculptural architecture with funny things, points and things on your buildings, that gives it a little bit sculptural idea. You're not yet a sculptor. Well, you are a sort of sculptor, but a very bad one. Next, please. Another example of precision, of poetics in architecture, is this famous bench by Gaudí and his pupil Jujol, because at the age that this band was made, Gaudí was completely mad. So it must have been his pupil Jujol who made it, and this is my invention. Anyway, in Barcelona and Paraguay. I think this is one of the most perfect pieces of architecture I know. Not only because it is so nicely decorated, but I mean this is a thing, a feature in itself. But the shape of the thing, the form of the thing is so perfect. And I'll tell you why. Because you know, there is this undulation is made such that there are places here that are such that you are when you're sitting, you're looking to the people opposite you, and you're sitting here, you can look to the people opposite you, and you are wherever you're sitting in this place, you're always together with the people who are sitting at the other side. So this is the sort of introvert situation, which is quite appropriate for having, for eating together, for having a picnic, and have a discussion, drinking together, and talking together. However, when you're sitting on this point here, where this lady is sitting, then you are quite alone, and you are looking into the space. So it's an extrovert thing. So when you are looking for somebody, and you try to find out whether he or she is already coming, you know, then you are sitting in this corner, where you can find out what's happening outside, you know. And when you are nicely together with people, sitting and eating and talking, you are in the other part. So the curve, so the way this form, this bench is woven, makes two different conditions, and of course what is in between, that are completely opposite, yet both quite, so to say, what you need, depending on the situation in which you are, waiting for somebody or eating with a group. And I think this is a fantastic example of the right organization of, in this case, a bench. And that's what architecture is, you know, the right organization. I mean, do not think that it is just make beautiful forms. It is, well, maybe Gaudí or Jujol, I don't know how they conceived the thing. What I learned from it is a story about the organization of conditions. Next. Talking about the organization of conditions, we are in Spain now, and this is in the courtyard of the famous mosque in Cordoba, where not only people are sitting in a beautiful way, which is sort of inspiration for what I was showing you, this sort of benches in the music center. When I said sidewalk, I had this in mind. So it's not made for it, but it's perfectly relevant for it. But I wanted to point out this idea, you know, a system of channels, of canals, to water the trees. And you see that here it's narrow to let the water move, and here it is wide to keep it in place and have it sink just on the place where the roots of the tree are. And this place, well, you could have made it rectangular or octagonal or hexagonal or whatever you want. You know, this is a discussion about form, but I think it's quite nice that these people, I don't think there was an architect who did it, but it's just somebody who knew about the organization of trees, water, and the speed of the water, and how you must do it to make the right thing with the minimum of water. And
It is organization in such a way that this round came, so to say, on itself, you know. And it is a sort of symbolic shadow of the tree, and it belongs to the tree. It's, so to say, the architectonic equivalent of a tree. And I think it's quite nice. It's explaining you how form is not a thing of beauty, but a thing of organization. And that I think is also the reason that for instance this big engineer's work, you know, these engineers are not concerned with form, just concerned with the minimum of material to bridge something or whatever, you know, that when they do their job in the right way, they found the unbelievable minimum of material. It's always so beautiful. I've never heard, people who said, "Well, it's the minimum of material, but look how ugly it is." It's always beautiful. I'm not saying that beauty comes just in itself on itself, but I'm just saying that you must not look for, not try to make something beautiful. The artist is not doing this. I don't know any painter. It's a misunderstanding that painters are trying to look for the beautiful thing. Painters are organizing things they want to do. They have ideas, themes they want to establish. And in some way or another, we think that beautiful. It is the same thing, you know, with the steps in Alhambra, where the water comes down, explained by the stairs, and the stairs is explained by the water. Water and stairs are, so to say, and steps are, so to say, reinforcing each other's identity, each other's personality. And I think this is a beautiful solution, which is just an invention. However, it is just the organization of the transport of water. Next. I mean, it's not quite true what I'm saying, but it's more true than just this foolishness of trying to make these gigantic sculptures which you think that are good. Next. Is it possible? Well, this is a school, the last school I did, it's not yet finished. You have the pavement, it's not that big. I mean, it's associated, you see the same sort of, here it's not the water that comes down, but I'm sure that making this concrete wall in the middle of these two pieces of steel work is believe it or not, associated by the idea of cutting a stairs by a water stream. And this school is it has been put there for some time by somebody who had no place in a sort of surrounding that does not fit quite well. But this is done on purpose because it's a very mediocre sort of gray environment of doubtful quality housing. And in the middle of this place, I did not adapt to that doubtful quality, but I decided to make something that is completely a sort of furniture from another world, which is put in the middle. Next. And what you see here is how this is quite uneasy, sitting somewhere not quite in the middle. And since the sun is coming from that side, I started, of course, to put it here, which would have been much nicer as a situation. But then the inhabitants here objected the idea, and I had to move away. And
they did not object. They stay here. Yeah?
The idea is to make clusters of three classrooms of, and two classrooms here share, so to say, a bay window. And there is a sliding door in between which can be opened, and when it's opened by means of this bow, what do you say, around, this becomes also one platform. Next. So you see that when the door is open, this window is not only part of one classroom, but of the two. When it's closed, you have, so to say, this angle of view. When it's open, it enlarges the angle of view in a considerable way. Next. This is the hall, and I'm going to show you the school I did before, and then I go into the idea of hall a little more. I just want to point out the fact that this is also quite sculptural and quite nice form, but many of you might have done it like this, you know, and apart from cutting the stones, which is not such a difficult thing to do. I would never have done this wall in this way. And I'll tell you why not. I mean, I love the form, and maybe it would have been better to have it in terms of form, to have it so. But in this big hall where there are large events with many people, I think you need to make as many places that are potentially sitting places as possible. So I started from the idea to make the sitting capacity competence rather than with the form. And I think that it is, after all, it's quite nice because you can understand that there's a stairs behind, you know? I think I'm just explaining you that all the time I'm working with form. But I'm approaching the idea of form from a slightly different way than many others. Next. So you see the clusters of classrooms, you know, two and one, so that's three, and then a split level, a little bit higher up, you have another three, and under this, there are another three. And what I wanted to explain you now here is the idea, what happened with this quite important stairs. The idea was that by making this form like this and this form like this, I could not make just straight stairs in this way, because I had the feeling that it did not work in terms of balance. And also I wanted to make, you know, this entrance in this direction. So you may say that I'm talking about axis. An axis. I tried first to make that straight, and then you make the stairs just with an angle. And it was quite stupid, you know. It was just like modern architecture, where they on purpose make all these axes that are a bit shifted, you know, to make a relationship with Berkeley Street, or with a relationship with this, a relationship with that. Well, you must put a plate on it to say, listen, this is on an angle because I wanted to make a relationship with heaven or with God knows. So I wanted an axis in the sense that when you come in just right in between these two points, and you see these doors are shifted in such a way that when you come in, step by step, you are going to the center of this hall. And then the idea came
children who are waiting to get into the school, and also because it's in the middle of the place, as a sort of playground for all the people around. Next, please. And then you see what happens. So here you see it in a picture, the way I try to just make this axis in this direction. And here you see the sort of playground that you get. And of course, it was easy that when you had this point, that you could make a little, well, not bench, but a little horizontal piece where one could sit quite well in this corner. Next. And you see here again how this is shifted. Next. And here you see what's going on. And it's in the model, it's quite easily done. You have this piece of cardboard, you bend it, and you find out that you can make this small stool sort of thing by cutting horizontally the cardboard and put it aside and put a piece of horizontal in it, you know. Well, and that then eventually is done in steel. And then the building police asked for something quite high, because when this is a horizontal plane, you need to have the full balustrade height on top of it. And first of it, I regret that very much. After that, I found out that it was very good what they said, because in fact, it is very nice to have this high up sort of wall that encloses this piece. So it was just quite nice to have this high wall, which is giving exactly the protection you need when you are talking together in this point. Next. And you see upstairs there's a balustrade in which this is a constant theme in my work, to try to make that extra quality in it, but not just a negative sort of thing of preventing from falling down, but to introduce where possible just this sitting quality thing. And this is a new form. I always experiment somewhere in a small corner to find out whether it works. And when it works, then I might do it in the next building, but then really. And here you see what is going on. By just making it in such a way, you have a quite low, you have a sort of thing which you don't recognize as a bench so quick, but you'll see that there are lots of kids sitting in it. I'm sorry, I cannot show it to you, but it is on the film. We just put to the developer, so tomorrow I can show you. It's the truth, you know. And it's not pay the children to sit there. Next. Well, you know, the other school you might know, because I've shown them 3 years ago, then they were just quite new. I just want to go into it quite quickly. There are two sort of big villas in a neighborhood full of villas. I did not make one single one family house. I'm a sort of architect. I don't know. I did not make houses, but I did not make seats. I'm not a real architect, I think. You must make houses, you must make seats. I did not do it. I made schools and I made lamps. But some people tell me, and they may be right, that I make the schools sort of unconsciously as houses. So somebody in Holland said, well, the way you make the schools, it's so as to
you would have liked to make a house. And what it is, in fact, is not putting classrooms in line, and it's very popular when you make a school. For some reason or another, it's another cliché in the architect's stereotype in the architect jargon is to make schools always with classrooms in line as a train, and with a corridor along where the people just are for circulation reasons and having their clothes and always bumping because there are too many children in that corridor. And I think it's much better to make next, please, to make a school around a hall. Or, well, this is something in between. These two schools are made of this. I didn't know, I forgot that I put in these pictures. This is, in fact, to show you that these two schools are one. One in the sense that they have the same grammar. And here you have all the points, all the meeting points, the structural points that there are. I'm sorry, there are not any more points than in this display. And it is the sort of grammar with which they are made. So this point you'll find somewhere. I don't know where, I think it's this one. Yes? And this one you can find, well, no, this one is. In fact, it is saying that I do not make one facade or one plan without knowing about all the others. And you cannot make the north facade on Monday and the south facade on Tuesday, because I have to know every point at the same time to be able to actually make the thing. So you can compare with the chess playing. When you are very bad in chess, you take one chessman and you move it. But then you'll find out that there is going something wrong with all the others. And so you cannot move one of the chessmen without knowing all the possibilities and all the dangers of all the other chessmen. And that, in fact, is a story about structuralism in architecture. So, but I'm not going into that now. Next. So grouping of the classrooms around one communal living room, which makes that when you leave your classroom, you are confronted with the others. You have a look. You can look into the other classroom and you see each other and you do something together. This is, of course, an organized party, and then, of course, it's quite nice to have this amphitheater thing, which is part of the split-level ID. You have not to care for all these seats, because you have them already there. And the idea of steps of amphitheater came in my mind all of a sudden, next please, when I was visiting in New York. Well, it doesn't matter, it could have been everywhere, because everywhere in the world you have this funny stairs that lead into important buildings. The more important they are, the larger the stairs. And we have a very important library here. The architect made this thing in order to have you lose all your energy before you are in, and so that you can come in there and say, a book for me. That is architecture, you know, because they did it in the Parthenon, so they have to do it constantly to the last day. But the interesting thing is that the whole system can turn around and maybe become a grandstand. So somewhere know, this quality I all of a sudden got by making this picture, and it is always with me, like many other pictures I have in my head, and which help to form themes. And the same thing happens, in fact, in this school where always people are sitting for to eat their sandwich or for some waiting or for any other thing. And there's always people downstairs, and all of a sudden there's going to be a theater relationship, the idea of performance and performers and listeners is quite spontaneously achieved. Next, please. Well, you see, also it is used for just working, because children are allowed to go work on themselves and leave the classroom and sit on one of these very large tables they find, and they're confronted with people from other classes, more grown up, doing more difficult work, and they learn from each other, and they are going to work together. So it's a large potential you have in your hands. You know, as an architect, you are creating conditions, and if not, you are, so to say, eliminating possibilities. So that's quite a responsibility. Too many buildings could have given more conditions for people to do the things they want to do. All this hall is lit by this big skylight, and in order to not obstruct the light coming down, there is this glass pavement in the stairs. Okay, next. Here you see the pavement, the glass pavement that let the light through. And of course it's quite beautiful, this glass pavement. Why don't we make all the stairs we make in glass pavement? I think people are going to do that maybe. But here it started, not because it's so nice, but because there was this necessity or this theme, how do you say this? I had on my list of conditions that it should let the light through, otherwise I would not have done it. But then you have to know, then you have to have the idea, the knowledge that you can make it in glass. And that is, of course, knowing your classics. And it was again, next picture, again, it has been Le Corbusier who did that first. And so Le Corbusier is of course the genius who was inventing all these things. However, this is the Maison Clarté in Geneva, and I happened to teach in Geneva, and I found out that there is a very strict law in Geneva to have natural light in your staircase. And so I have an idea that it was that Le Corbusier might have been forced to do it, you know, because if you know the sketches of his apartments, he was trying like a Japanese puzzle to make as many apartments in that building. And I think he had to do that because his client wanted to earn so much money. So you know that story. There must always be more apartments in the thing. And then he was quite happy, and he went to the building authorities with his plan. And they said, "No, sir, you can't do that, because natural light in your staircase. So go home and make it a larger opening. And then he must have said, oh, but it's impossible because we have that cost me so many apartments, 16 or something. And then the man must have said, well, I'm sorry, but natural light in your staircase, so come back when you have done your homework. And then he must have thought, how can I solve that? And then, of course, the stroke from God came to his genius and said, well, transparent flooring. And that is because he was so such a genius. But it's also possible that he was not only a genius, but that also he knew his classics. Because next painting, the next picture, next piece. Because he must have known that in 1914, Bruno Taut was making in the Cologne Pavilion also this transparent flooring. And so Bruno Taut is a genius and not the prodigy. But I did not meet Bruno Taut, but I can imagine with a little detective attitude, what must have happened there, over there, because this was the exhibition pavilion for a glass factory. And Bruno Taut was asked to make a pavilion with as much glass as possible. So he made a skylight, and he made glass bricks in the wall. And then he came up to his client and said, well, here, this is my project, is that all? Couldn't you make more glass in it? We have to sell glass, you know. And then he said, well, okay, if you like, we could make the stairs of glass. Of course, make everything glass also. So in this way, the whole thing started. So I'm sure that it is not true that creation, Gus, standing for the open window, looking out and waiting for the mighty stroke of God that gives you the inspiration. And all these architects, you know, they look like they have they're stroken by God, and they look like and then I'm sitting and standing for the window, and then it comes, and then I have my board, I don't think it's true. I don't think it's true. Well, some of them, you know, maybe I'm not going to mention names, but some of them have it, but not so many. I think most of them are just very hardworking in the work of Le Corbusier. It's patient search, and it is much more of the organization of things that I get. Next, please. My own staircase at the outside of the same building is also transparent, and here the idea was quite strange idea, but I wanted to make a very large staircase in order to accommodate the entrance of the primary school upstairs. But I did not. The problem was the stairs up to the entrance of the primary school should be very large and generous, you know, to house, to be inviting to the many children who come in and wait and want to make a school photo, and all the things you do on the stairs. But underneath there's the entrance of the kindergarten, and I think making